Yo, what's up, guys? We are live. Welcome back to Exposé. Today is, what day is it? I should probably know that before we broadcast. Today is June 19th, 2015. I'm joined on this broadcast, of course, by you guys and also by Andrei, Jikh, Christen, Gerhart, and we will have Calen, Morelli on this broadcast as well. Just like before, a few quick things. Go, if you're not there already, go to theory11.com/expose. That's where you can chat live, ask questions, talk about things, and hang out during this live event. We are broadcasting this live. If you're watching this later, it's obviously not live. But right now it's live, so post your questions, chat with us during the broadcast. We'll be reading your questions during the broadcast, and Calen will be on for the second half of this episode. But first, I'm joined by Andrei Jikh. I'm joined by Christen Gerhart. Both of you guys can hear me okay?
Yes.
Yep.
Welcome. How's it going?
Good.
Thank you, Calen.
Andrei got new glasses. I want to talk about that before we really get started.
Let's not do that.
First major news story this week is about Andrei's glasses. He's trying to look less like Harry Potter with the circular glasses.
But yes, I'm trying to get away from that.
Not fooling nobody.
Not fooling nobody.
So anyways, yes, we got a full episode this week. We've got news. We're going to be bringing you the latest releases. We're talking with Calen Morelli, but let's get started. Welcome to Exposé.
We made it this far. 10 seconds into the broadcast.
Done. Completed. Thank you all for joining us. See you next week. What's going on? Kristen, let's start with the news. What happened in the magic sphere?
Well, coming up very soon, as we've been talking about on previous episodes of Exposé, Penn & Teller will be returning to Broadway, and that's July 7th, begins their six-week reign on Broadway. And they sat down with the New York Times recently, and the New York Times published a really cool article about Penn & Teller kind of talking about not only how New York has changed since they were last there, not since they last visited, but I'm sure since the show was last there, but also how their show itself has changed and what you kind of can expect to see in their new Broadway show, which is very interesting.
There's a lot of magic going on in New York right now. There's that show, obviously, Penn & Teller, which starts when? Mid-July, right?
July 7th begins.
Yes. And then there's, what else was I alluding to? There's more than that. There's Steve Cohen's show, obviously, at the Waldorf Astoria. Dan White's show that we produced at the Nomad Hotel. So, yeah, there's a lot of magic, a lot of really good magic in New York. So if you're in the New York area, definitely check all those out. It's a good time to like magic in New York.
Also, The Illusionists will be returning to Broadway in, November of this year? So not quite right now, but very soon New York's going to have even more magic.
Yes, and what was the other show? The Illusionist is the show with Dan Sperry and that ensemble cast. Then there's the show The Impossible Live, which is the show in London, right?
Yes, not New York.
Yeah, so yeah, there's a lot of ensemble magic shows happening right now. There's The Illusionist, which is Supernaturalist. There's The Impossibilist. We're going to run out of adjectives to describe incredible things. Yes.
We're going to have, people that do really awesome stuff. Ists.
Cool.
Yeah. In more Penn & Teller news, on July 6th, right before they open at Broadway, the CW will be airing the new Fool Us, which I'm very excited about.
This is the new season of Fool Us?
Yes. Correct.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of people that are friends of Theory 11 on this new season. Blake Boyd's going to be on the new season. I think Spidey is on that new season. Who else is on this new season?
Well, there's Penn and there's Teller, I'm assuming.
yes, there's those guys. I think they're important throughout it. I don't know. If you haven't seen this already, by the way, everyone should go check out Matthew Beach's performance on Fool Us. It was still one of my favorites that he successfully fooled, not us, but them. He fooled me too, but he fooled them.
When I was last at Magic Live, total tangent, but I'm going to say it because it involves Matthew Beach, and it's the only Matthew Beach story I have.
Go for it.
I was at Chris Kenner's house, and we was having a party, and I'm standing there, and Matthew Beach comes up to me and just says, hello, and he just stands in front of me. And I just look at him like, hi. And I must have seemed like the strangest person in the world. I had no control over myself, so I couldn't speak, and I couldn't, be normal. It was super awkward. And
Matthew Beach has that.
He does. I was just paralyzed by the beatings.
It was his gaze, just staring into your eyes, and his ponytail was too much to handle.
It was magical. It was really magical. Okay, yeah. And then to round up the news, Darcy just announced the remainder of his tour dates for the rest of 2015. So now to Christmas, through Christmas, you can get all of your Darcy Oak fix by
finding out. Where is he touring?
It's mostly going to be in Canada. So if you're in Canada, you're in luck. Yay!
Yeah, so we have a good amount of geography covered. For people in the U.S., there's a lot of magic in New York City. There's obviously a lot of magic in Las Vegas. If you're in London, I think Garen Brown's still on tour. If he's not, he
might. Oh my gosh, Garen Brown.
Do I need to give you a minute?
Just had a moment.
So, yeah, there's a lot of live magic happening.
Yep, so that's the news. Basically, go find a show that interests you and buy tickets and also a plane ticket.
Right? All right. So, JB, are you wearing pants right now?
Yeah, why is everyone in the chat asking if I'm wearing pants? Is there like some really around that I do expose pants? There's like a mirror behind me. You guys can see. I'm not going to confirm or deny anything.
See, that's why it keeps happening. You're perpetuating the mystery.
Listen, it's warm here. It's not
long sleeve shirt, but no pants. That's the new standard.
It's a new style. It's really big in Milan right now. It's a big fashion rage going around.
You give them what they want.
Yes. Milan right. Fashion Week.
First things first. So my good friends, the Surrealists, if you guys have heard of them, which are, of course, Spidey, who's had a ton of releases with us the past, including the recent one we did, Break, and my new friends that I just recently met here in Vegas,
Joe Myers.
They're so nice. I love those guys. And they got the first perfect score of the season with their amazing performance on True TV's Fake Off. And as I understand it, I think it's the first time that show has ever awarded a perfect score. But just to be on the safe side, it's the perfect score.
So this show, for people that haven't seen it yet, it's basically like they have a team of people from various like disciplines of like theater and everything, and their task is to create this dramatic experience or sequence or routine on stage. And it sort of seems, in my perception, the one with the most wow factor wins. So that's
exactly, yeah. They're using deception essentially as a vehicle, or rather deception as the grand idea, and then whatever their art form is, whether that's magic, dance, or shadow puppetry, or breakdance, whatever it is, they're using that as a vehicle to deceive. And it's really like high-end production. And you know, I got a clip loaded for you guys to see their performance, which was the semifinals, which they got a perfect score on. And it looks really, really great. It's kind of long, it's 2 minutes, but it's really great. Check it out.
We got a technical problem. It's going to be a minute. We're back. Okay, get him out of the chair. Let's reset and take it from the top.
Time!
How's that for a thing?
That's pretty scary. That was pretty intense.
Pretty cool, right? Like, I think that's great. The judges were not expecting the twist at the end, so that's really
cool. Yeah, she, like, screamed in fear and then ran up and hugged him, which is a natural reaction when you're afraid.
That's what I do when I'm terrified. I go hug the nearest person.
You know.
So also this week we have several new Wire releases, two of which are Cardistry ones, beginning with Lapsus by Tim Ananiev, which is a cluster of amazing motions. I don't even know how to describe it, but come to think of it, how many Cardistry moves can you actually describe in a visual sense where you're like, oh, I get it, without saying something vague like, it's smooth, and it uses two hands.
I like triangular motion, too. You can just, I don't know.
Yeah, so here's the trailer instead.
Better to watch it, as a usual thing.
Check it out. Dope sauce. It's great.
Love dope it. Sauce.
Yes. And
what if that was
the
an actual
second,
thing?
Right? that's a flavor.
I don't think I'd be very excited about it.
So the second release we have is with Nikolai Orenchak called Dream. Like Dream, but with two E's.
Is it possible that was just a misspelling?
It could be, and our team totally missed it, but I'd like to think that it was intentional. But it's free. It's free, so it's that much more awesome. Check it out.
Which also has two E's.
Maybe you misspelled it.
Also with two E's, free. Awesome. Looks great. I love it.
Looks great.
And last but not least is a Magic release that fooled the crap out of me. I had to watch it like 5 times before I finally still didn't figure it out. it's really good. It's called Quantum Leap. It's by Justin Morris, and it's actually obviously a play on words, quantum leap in physics, but it's essentially a coin about the size of a quarter or less, and it travels instantaneously through a playing card. So it's exactly like what David Copperfield did walking through the Great Wall of China. And this is just like that, but it's for everyone with a slightly smaller budget. And I suspect a different method, too. But anyway, here's what it looks like. Could be wrong. But Quantum Leap. Check it out. Pretty cool, right?
Yeah.
So obviously he has a trap door in his thumb.
Well, yeah, gimmicked guy. It takes like 30 seconds to set this up, though, once you know how it's done. It's like $2.95 or $3.95. But it's amazing. Like, within 30 seconds, you'll be able to do this. And it's
what is that? What is that called?
It's called Quantum Leap.
Quantum Leap. So check Quantum that out. Joined by the other two releases, which are Wire releases this week, theory11.com/Wire.
No gimmicks. Just kidding. There's a gimmick, but it takes 30 seconds. So anyway.
The card is gimmicks.
They have gimmicks. Hands. Gimmicked hands.
This is true. This looks like a real hand, but it's not. This is fake. I got this on the Amazon.
Like Tom Cruise, that scene. That's gimmicks. It for me.
Awesome. So if you guys are just joining us, there's a lot of new people I'm seeing in the chat room right now. If you're watching this on YouTube, go to theory11.com/expose. That's where you can join us live in the chat. In a few moments, we're going to be joined by Mr. Calen Morelli. He's created Dress Code. He's created a lot of other things. He's consulted for almost everyone who's anybody doing magic on television or on stage. And this week, he's going to be joining us live here on Exposé, taking questions from you guys. So these can be questions about him as a performer, consulting for magic on television, doing magic on television, and doing magic on stage. So get your questions brewing now. Calen will be here in a few moments. Let's summon Calen. I'm actually going to send him a text message right now. He will be with us in a moment. So, but yeah, get your questions ready for Calen, and he'll be here just shortly. Let's see here.
In the meantime,
Andrei's going to tap it.
Wait, really? That would be awesome.
It could happen. I'm reading some questions in the chat. Andrei, someone's asking, how do you choose what goes on the wire and what doesn't? We obviously have a bunch of criteria. We try to be rather objective with it as possible, but it is a subjective thing. We try to keep focus on quality over quantity. We don't just release things on the wire to populate the wire. We want everything to kind of earn its place in that marketplace.
Thanks, Calen's Andrei. Here.
What's up, Andrei?
What's up? What's up, Calen?
What's up? You guys look good.
Calen Morelli, everybody. Welcome. So, Calen, you are joined by myself, Andrei, and Christen, and a few bazillion other people in our chat room live right now. There's a bunch of questions coming in, the first of which is about your nipples. I kid you not.
What?
Yes, the first, it's a long story. It refers to Blake was talking about your, anyway, whoa, that's going to sound weird. I was about to say Blake was talking about your nipples last week on Exposé.
So that's kind of true.
It was absolutely true.
Crazy. All right.
The frequent topic of conversation in my life. Welcome, Calen. How's it going? Where are you broadcasting from?
I'm at my house in Vegas.
You're in Vegas.
Yeah, Las Vegas. It's pretty warm out here, but it's not too shabby.
Yes, probably 1,000 degrees in Vegas right now, middle of summertime.
Typical.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You'll be melting momentarily. Awesome. Have you been mostly in town in Vegas, or have you been traveling in and out working on projects?
Lately, for the last, 2 months, I've been working on a project, or last about a month and a half, yeah. So I was out in L.A. for working on a little consulting stuff. So it was good. Some exciting stuff that I think will, drop this summer, and more magic shows on TV.
For people, I guess to get things started, there's a lot of questions coming in our chat. We'll get to a bunch of them throughout this episode, but for people unaware of your existence. Where are you from? How did you get started in the industry? What was your first consulting gig? I know you've done a lot of consulting and creating recently.
So for someone that's just kind of tuning in, I mean, I grew up in Oregon, and I grew up on a farm town. Got into magic, creating stuff, when my whole family stayed with my grandparents and stuff. So we. I worked on creating a bunch of stuff, and then I did something with this little company called Theory 11. And
yeah, wait, what was that one more time? What's the website address?
Was it not clear enough to get an audio sample? Theory11.com. So I put out this thing called Dress Code, which was a crazy receptive trick. It got a lot of great feedback, and you just it lets you change your shirt. And then from that, it blossomed.
Blake was on our show last week when he told the story of meeting you digitally. What was that story? Was he the first magic creator, collaborator that you kind of tag team creative process with, or did you have magician friends growing up?
I didn't have any magician friends growing up. 3 years into doing magic, I'd met some people online, but I'd never really met a magician until maybe 3 or 4 years after doing magic. But as far as collaborating really with people, when I did my blog, the 365 Days of Magic, I hung out with Chase Duncan online a lot, and this dude named Austin Fields, they were my homies that like helped me just like I'd be like, yo, is this complete shit? Is this like a good idea? Is this like gonna be something that's like worth putting up? And then, you know, I just needed like some friend feedback that was like some, you know, constructive criticism. So, and then so, after that,
before you go on from this, talk about the 365 project for a second, because a lot of people that are listening to this might not have been aware of what that is, what that was. So you
I mean technically it doesn't exist online anymore.
Yeah, so there's no way for them to know about it unless you were witnessing it as a part of it. But basically, you challenge yourself to create a new magic effect every day for 365 days. You didn't make it.
Yeah, and it's crazy
because it's very crazy.
I didn't. Well, the crazy thing is this was like, so this was kind of before creating magic tricks was like the cool thing to do, I feel like. Because now it seems like with Wizard Wars, like what Christen was on, you know, and like it seems like a very kind of cool thing to like create magic tricks now. Like it's kind of like stepping into like the genre of like, you know, it's cool to be like a singer-songwriter and not just have, you know, people pay people to make it for you. But yeah, I did a trick a day, and then after like 200 days, yeah, me and Blake actually got an interview with D. Copperfield,
and that guy.
So we went up to his lair at the top of the MGM and showed him some stuff, and that happened for a couple years. So,
and before that, was that your first consulting, creating magic for someone other than yourself?
Yeah, it was.
So is that like, were you intimidated? Show magic to going from zero to not
zero to even, like a thousand? Quick.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's see. I was actually, you know, I remember that meeting very weirdly because Blake, since I met him in person, he was always a much better talker than me. Because like my brain would like stop halfway through a sentence, and if you talk to me, it's hard sometimes to have a conversation with me if I'm in the middle of like trying to solve a problem, because I'll be like 100 miles away. Just like it sucks. And like my friends know that, and it's kind of shitty, but like, you know, it's gotten better over the years. But anyways, so Blake, we were going into this, like Blake was going to do the talking. And then Blake just shut up a little bit. Like he just didn't really talk. And he dropped a couple really great tricks. But then I ended up like really able to talk at that point. And like it was weird. Like I never got a compliment on being like, hey, that kid knows how to talk. I'm like, what? This is crazy.
Did you show him magic tricks in that first meeting, or was it mostly just talking?
You know what's crazy? Blake showed him regen, and I think I might have showed him dress code just in person, just like trying to like work into the conversation. But honestly, mostly I use my 365 project, because right then I had like 200 ideas, and I use that like as a resume. Like as we were talking about stuff, I like had my laptop, so I just like pull up a video or something and kind of illustrate it with that idea.
What was the inspiration? Why did you challenge yourself? Why did you challenge yourself to the 365 project? What was it like a bet that you could do this, or was there a reason, a creative reason why you did that?
All right. So the basis idea I think came from this kid named Casey Rudd. Like it was I think we were on like on the magic plays, or it was the magic session back in the day when it was like that thing when people used to go on that. And I think he like offhandedly threw out like a comment like, yo, you literally like come on here every day with new stuff. You should like try and do that for a year. That'd be crazy. And like, it was like a random comment. And then I think later on that day or the next day, I was like,
challenge accepted.
That literally seems impossible. Challenge accepted. And then it was actually the first 10 days that I tried to do it. After like 10 days, I went out to New York to meet you the first time to film Dress Code. And that put me behind, like literally, because I think I went to Ohio also, so it put me behind like 8 or 9 days. So I told myself if I couldn't catch up with like 8 or 9 ideas in the first day and a half that I got back for 2 days, then I was just going to quit. I literally pulled like a 48-hour like session just to like make that happen, but
wow.
Glad I didn't quit. So Cool. Is there, are there things that you learned throughout that process, that, that whatever 200 days that you, you went through it, that you are still affected by, like the creative process that you learned to be so prolific and actually maintain quality? Because it's one thing to do something repeatedly every day, and it becomes like a chore, and it's like you just do go through the motions of it. But yours was not that. There's a, there's, you know, day 48 is awesome, and like, so, like you can still look back on these effects and they stood the test.
I mean, there's still a lot of shit effects in there. Like, and I mean, I think I recreated some stuff that was like basic stuff, just because partly with like my creation process is I don't like, I didn't read a lot of books or watch a lot of DVDs or anything growing up or learning magic. So most of the time when I created something, I would think it's new. And whether it's like, I think I created like a Hofzinser card at like on one of the days. And I was like, yo, this is dope. This is so good. And then some kid on like Facebook. Yeah, some kid on Facebook's like, yo, that's definitely been around. I'm like, all right, cool. Touche.
You just got to wait until tomorrow, or I'm going to invent a time machine to go back to Hofzinser time, and then I'm going to recreate it.
But I don't know. I try not get like stifled by like things that, the way things that have been done a certain way or how people do certain things. So yeah, that does involve in like recreating some stuff that people have already done. But in the long run, for me, it just leaves my mind like more like just open to like when I have a problem, I'll just be like, what could I do? How do I Walt Disney this? You know? So
did you have inspirations of different creators that you looked up to, different performers you looked up to? Who were your magic idols growing up in magic, like your first exposure to magic? What inspired you to get started?
Yeah, I mean, that's like such a cliche question, but it's a good one because, I mean, performance-wise, it's been David Blaine. It's like David Blaine, I feel like he embodies kind of from like 1998 to 2000, maybe 10, he embodied like what it was to be a cool magician, or he connected with the culture that we lived in those years. Like, I'm not saying he doesn't connect now, but in those like 10 years, he connected so well with like the culture and the time that we live in that like, I for me, that was just like my inspiration of how to, you know, how to connect with the time that I live in with what I do and make it relevant to people. So David Blaine was definitely like performance-wise, creation-wise. Daniel Garcia was like early on. Daniel Garcia and Paul Harris was like they were the shit. They still are, but yeah, when they were like putting out stuff, or like when Garcia was mainly, man, like I remember, like when I lived with my grandparents, like in like right after I graduated, because like my family went through some bullshit and we had to like move into my grandparents' for like house for like 6 months. They had like the slowest internet. Like to load a demo, it would take like I think like two and a half hours. So like if like Garcia's like new like DVD demo was gonna drop, I would literally like load that video for like 2 or 3 hours, and then I would watch it. And it made me really appreciate like demos and stuff. I was like, damn, this is gonna be dope. This is gonna be fresh. So.
What's your creative process like? Are you the kind of person that like sits down and just like has like a 48-hour marathon, or do you kind of create a little bit all the time, or do you set aside time for yourself to do that, or what kind of like helps you in your creative process when you're trying to put out new magic?
Usually I create a lot of bullshit, and then I wait for like, because like you can't be inspired all the time, right? Mm-hmm. But when like inspiration hits you, then you have to be like ready for it. So whenever I try and keep up to like, just I try and create like something stupid every day, and then if when I get really inspired from something and like something connects, where it's maybe it's a song and this visual, I'm like, then my like my sharpness of just like how my mind, I hope it will work, will just be on point, and then, you know, hopefully I can just live that out.
Is there anything specific that you do to keep inspired? And like, because like you said, we all have moments where we're not inspired, and sometimes it's just like you're just so sick of trying to create something. Do you fight that feeling, or do you kind of just like let it be and then just like see what inspires you?
It gets me so depressed sometimes.
Right. No, me too. I totally feel
it. It does, because I'm like I think part of being creative is actually believing that you can make something that's never been done before. Like, you have to actually believe that in your fucking soul. Sorry. Like, you have to, like, believe that. You have to believe that, like, really, really solid. Like, if you don't actually believe that's possible, then it's pointless. Because, I mean, what's the point of working on something if you don't actually believe that you can do it? And you got to have that, like, confidence that you can create something new and that it can be just as good as, like, something that
What do you do personally to get it back? What do you personally do to get that strike or, like, that stroke of inspiration back into your life? Do you, like, go out and watch movies, or do you go out and film a video, and, like, do you force yourself to get out of that rut, or do you just
I usually have, like,
time, like...
Yeah. I usually have a... I have, like, some inspirational, like, things that inspire me, whether it's, like, clips of artists, music artists that I like, or other, like, magic acts that I've seen that just, like, blew me away. And I haven't lately, but I used to, like, have, like, a 10-minute roll, like, a reel that I would watch, like, every morning just to try and wake up and get in that mindset, like, when I was...
The Justin Bieber documentary?
No. Ooh, cold.
No, that's not a burn. We used to watch all that together with Michael. It was...
That's true. I forgot that. No, the first 2 minutes on that documentary was dope. That was really...
No, it's great.
Where do you normally get inspiration from? Is it outside of magic? Is it music? Is it movies? Is it TV?
I mean, I try and draw it from everything. Like, what sucks is I can't really watch anything without trying to get inspired from it. Like, whether if I'm watching a TV show, I'm watching how they pair the music with what type of scene is going on, or how they visually tell something that is, like, subtle, and it's not, like, a blatantly, like, this is what I'm doing. So then it's just, like, I'm always just, like, my brain's always, like, working on shit like that. So it's kind of tough, like, to just watch something and just not worry about, like, how it's being made or why they're doing what they're doing.
Right.
But, yeah.
I have another question. Does magic influence your music and vice versa?
Not directly. Like, for me, I don't know. I have a really weird music taste. Like, I listen to, like, a lot of different stuff. But
Christen listens to some stuff.
What?
Christen listens to, like, death metal and...
Okay, we're not talking about me right now. Okay.
then,
we're talking about Calen.
Yeah, I can't... I don't understand that music, but I appreciate, like, the people that make it.
Nobody understands that music.
That it exists.
Let's see. For me, honestly, like, I kind of... I'm more... The things that inspire me more now... are the way that people are, like, handling, like, their careers, like, artists, and how they either get people hyped up to see shows, or, like, just how they handle the people that enjoy what they're doing. So if I'm going to watch, like, a music artist, it's not necessarily for the music. It's just for about how they, you know, how they're acting, how they're being them, and just, I guess, not necessarily... So.
Did you always like music? Like, growing up, were you always, like, super musical? Like, you liked, not necessarily rapping, but you were into the music scene when you were growing up. Is that true?
No. So,
for me, it wasn't. No, it never was either. Like, I took it out on cardistry. Like, a lot of people, you know, they develop a sense of, you know, perspective on music because if they're going through a rough time or they want to be creative, they tune into the music and they follow bands and songs. And I never did that as a kid. I think maybe JB is probably the same way. I don't particularly feel like JB is very, like, musical. Like, he likes music maybe, but he's not, like, I don't think he goes to concerts. It's not his thing as much because probably growing up, we were so focused on magic and cardistry. So at what point, in your life did you just...
As an expression of self and whatever that is that you do, if that's creating, drawing, creating magic, whatever it is.
So the question is, did you discover music later on?
So I don't think I listened or owned an album like I had a CD player, but I didn't listen to any music purposefully probably up until like my junior year of high school, and then I had like one album, but it was weird because like my family is like they're very kind of they're very religious, very Christian, so like I think I was mostly only introduced to like kind of like Christian music, and I didn't like really vibe with that a whole lot. So then in like my senior year, my friend Shane, he kind of introduced me back when there was like LimeWire and stuff. He introduced me to like Nirvana, Sublime, and like right. Red Hot Chili Peppers and stuff like that. And then from there, like I started to listen to music all the time when I would like create stuff. But before like 18, I didn't listen to hardly anything.
We got about 15, 20 minutes left, so you guys in the chat, post your questions in the chat now. We're going to get to as many as we can in the remaining minutes here. We're going to do a comment contest before this thing ends. But there's a few more questions that I already see coming in here now. Calen, can you talk about the difference between your creative process when you're working on a project for television versus using the creative process for something that's like live magic? So like, what's the difference? You know, you worked with David Blaine on his last television special. That was for TV. Obviously, he's performing that stuff for people live, but it's the majority of the audience is on television. Versus when you worked with Copperfield, that was pretty much it was the opposite. It was the majority of the audience was there live. Is there a different creative process that you go through for that? Is one more difficult than the other? Is one more fun than the other?
So the process to create TV magic has to be like very, you have to be very fast with it. Because usually, like for instance, sometimes they'll be like, okay, we're gonna do a shoot tomorrow afternoon, and it's already 11 o'clock, then like the day before, and we need a four-phase routine with money that this person that the person that's doing the TV show can have practiced by, you know, by rehearsals at 1 o'clock tomorrow. So it's like less than 24 hours and you have to work out a full routine. Now we don't necessarily like always create new methods, but we try and like at least give something, add something to each thing. And we try and, you know, at least have something that's like at least 50% original. So with TV, it's a really, you have to stay really calm and just be like, okay, you know, I've had some crazy stories. Like, when I was the first week that I consulted for Dynamo, I actually took over Blake's position because he couldn't go back to Africa. So I went to Africa with Rico and Doug McKenzie. And me and Rico and I were in the middle of, we were like an hour and a half out of Cape Town in this small little, in this crazy like makeshift village. And we were in this van and we thought we were headed back to camp, but then literally, they like were like, oh no, we have to film this last effect where like something like a coal or something in a fire changes into like money or a diamond. And we're like, what? Because we had been working on something else all day. And I mean, we had rough ideas for gimmicks in this like in our like kind of case, but literally, so then we came up with this like three-phase routine in like 25 minutes in the van with like only the things we had on us, and then taught it to Dynamo. And it looked really dope. Like, I was actually really proud of it. And, like, that kind of situation, it's just, like, kind of a mindset of being like, okay, well, we have to do this. Like, there's no option to fail. Like, it's just, yes, yeah, we can do it. And that's kind of like with the TV thing, I think. You just have to always be the yes person. You have to always just say, yeah. You just have to be able to make it happen. But with, like, I don't do a lot of live performing in the sense of like what normal is, like whether it's like strolling magic or whether it's like stage magic. I mean, I do like, I'll go and do like a 10-minute set if like a friend's like at a hip hop show or something, and he's gonna like my beatboxer friend of mine does a lot of shows, so I'll like open for him sometimes or whatnot. But you know, like when I was working for Copperfield, Copperfield knows how to make an idea and turn it into like a full routine. So honestly, we would give him like the basis of ideas, and then we would learn from him on how to take that idea and turn it into something that, you know, 600 people can enjoy. So it's kind of like a give and a take on both of those, like that first job that I worked with Copperfield. And most of the other ones have been all TV stuff. So
Is there a difference in the creative process also, just because in one format television, people can watch it in HD and they can replay that performance 10 times versus live, where you're manipulating someone's attention or using some concept that they can't rewind a live performance on stage at Copperfield, whereas they can with every single effect that you're working on with David Blaine or Dynamo?
Yeah. Yeah, everything, honestly though, like, most of the stuff is left up to the editors on how that looks, like, for, like, TV shows and stuff. Like, yes, like, whether a gimmick has to look, like, clean or something, yes, it does, but honestly, I've seen some, there's been some shoots I've been on that have been, just happened. Like, this dude looks like he, like, purposefully did everything, and like, so really it's like you can make like an average person look great on TV, and that's just kind of how it's always been.
Someone on here asked, what's your go-to effect right now to perform, or maybe something you even like seeing?
Lately it's been like just kind of like mnemonicosis, like, so it's just like freestyling with like a memorized deck for like the past week and a half. That's been what I've been into lately.
Tell us a story. It's a good question from Carson C. He's saying, what's the deal behind that viral video you made last year? I just checked. It's up to 16 million views. 16 million. That's actually on your official channel. There's other people that have reposted it that have hundreds of thousands of views as well, so it's probably over 20 million views overall. What was that story for that whole, was it a, like, you expected that was going to blow up the way it did? Was that just like you woke up one day and were like, you had a million views of a video and it was featured everywhere?
I mean, that was like a purposeful mate. Like, out of any video I've ever done, that was like, That was like a viral video formula of like, I mean, from the way I named it, from the how long it was, I kept it under like, you know, like a minute. I think it was like under a minute 20. It was really easy to follow. It wasn't like it was a one shot thing, so it looked kind of like interesting. Like, I mean, I followed like all the viral video formats to like try and make that pick up. And yeah, it did. It was wild. Like, I posted it at like 1 o'clock the night before, and like, because I literally was just like, screw it, I'm just gonna put it up. And then the next morning, it started like picking up like crazy, and it went from like 60,000 to 600 to like just a ridiculous amount. So it was like it was interesting.
If you could do it all over again, would you do anything differently?
No, I fight with myself on this, because I'm like, yo, does it matter if someone knows that you acted in a video? Because, I mean, technically, all a magician is an actor playing the part of a magician, if, like, right, if they're actually good at it. So, to me, part of me, like, deep down, I really don't care if people know that it's acting, because I still think that that's a skill in itself, and I think that the way that like the video was put on was really, really smart. But like, people, I don't know, people didn't really like see that same view as me. Like, they're like, oh, well, if it's an acting, then it's fake, and it's fake magic, and it's this and that.
As opposed to real magic, right?
But you see that, like there's still stupid people like trying to convince people that what they're doing is not a skill and not like something that they take time on.
Yeah, like, so I rewatched Darren Brown's most recent, or actually this is not his most recent, it's last year's show, I believe Infamous, which is the one that was co-written by Andy Nyman, and the very first thing that he says on stage in the opening monologue is that, you know, there's people that pretend to have psychic skills, which I don't have, and there's people that pretend to have magical powers, which I absolutely don't. And he establishes that from the start. He kind of says I'm a liar, but that doesn't negate everything else that is that he does for the rest of the hour television special. It's incredible.
Right, and the problem now is, like, all these people,
are like worried about whether or not. To me, I don't think it matters if someone knows how a trick is done. I honestly don't, because because someone knows how a trick is done, there's way too much information right now for people to be fooled 100% of the time. Yes, there are things that are more fooling than other things, but let's say, but it doesn't take away from like the visual or like what you're showing people. You know, like if you're gonna like float a dollar bill, okay? If you're gonna make it look like a dollar bill's floating, okay? That looks pretty dope, like depending on the handling that you do. And if they cannot see the string, then you're technically doing your job. Now, I don't care if someone knows your string there, because at the end of the day, like, they could type in to Google, even if they didn't know, they could be like, how's a floating dollar bill work? Oh, this uses this really thin hair. Cool. Then they figure it out. So, like, if I'm doing my job and people aren't able to see how it works in the moment, and if it can make them feel a certain way, and if they enjoyed watching it, then the method is irrelevant. And if they know how it's done, it doesn't matter to me.
Yeah, so you're saying the ends justify the means. That's the theory behind it.
Sort of, yeah. Like there's this thing in like the James Brown movie, like Get On Up, where it's they're like doing this like drum beat that's like off time, and like he wants to put this like this kick in at a weird like moment, and they're like, that just doesn't make sense with like the timing. And he's like, does it sound good? Does it feel good? Then it's music. Like, right. So it's like, to me, I don't know. I think people, I think it should be less about whether or not, less about whether or not, you know, you're fooling someone, and more about like how you're making them feel or trying to make them feel.
I just saw Jurassic World, which is pretty rad. But like, I at no point while watching that movie did I believe that dinosaurs are real. Like, I was aware of the fact that this was a movie, and you have to like suspend your doubts and disbeliefs for a moment. Just enjoy the entertainment experience. And magic is kind of along the same lines, where if someone's a good performer and they make you feel good, they make you laugh, and you're engaging and they're captivating, and what they're showing you is compelling, then you're doing your job. You're an entertainer. You're a performer. That's your job.
The crazy thing, though, is no one's actually made a really, really successful career, in my opinion. I mean, you technically could count David as that, but, like, I mean, in the last, like, 10 or 15 years, like, no one's really, like, hit on that to where this, like, deep, mysterious thing. It's more about just kind of, you know, entertaining people with, I don't know, it's such a weird thing. Being entertaining with magic without being like too dark and mysterious is like weird, because, you know, it just, some people want to believe that it's like something else, and some people don't care. It's just such a weird line that it's still a little blurry for people, so it makes it really difficult.
I think that just means you have to like establish what your character is. Are you a character that's like Justin Willman, where he clearly is not proclaiming to be an actual warlock and he's just here to have fun with it and make the audience feel good? Or are you a performer who's more like David Blaine, who will, you know, kind of deadpan stare, like, watch, look, I'll make the card turn over. And he's more like a mysterious, you know, shaman type character.
People could still have a popular character like David Blaine if they just like twisted it a little bit. But like I would say, including myself at the moment, like I'm trying to do something different. Like I'm working on new stuff, but like including myself, like I don't see anyone kind of breaking out of the mold and like not being afraid to be different and try something really new. Like I feel like just a lot of people are a little bit scared just because, you know, about what people's gonna like judge them or what they're gonna say. So that's kind of my thoughts on it.
When you were starting in magic, not just as a creator but as a performer, a fan of magic, was there like a persona that you really respected? Like, was it David Blaine? Because oftentimes I know, like, for example, when I started performing magic, I was absolutely obsessed with David Copperfield. It was the first magic show I had ever seen. It was the only magician I'd ever seen, so it was really the only reference. It wasn't like music, right?
You want to know why David Copperfield and David Blaine are copied so much, it's because those two personas are able, that they connect with people. That, like, that performance style connects with people on, like, a deep level. And, like, old Copperfield stuff did, and David Blaine's, like, performance style really connects with people. And there's not really a lot of other ways that, or I haven't seen anyone that's really found a way to connect with people in, like, a different way a little bit. And it doesn't even have to be that different, you know? It's just, like, and it's just honestly trial and error. It seems
that the key to success is using magic as nothing more than a vehicle to really tell a bigger story, kind of like Copperfield with his career. The focus is not even so much about the magic, but about dreams and accomplishment, like about reaching
performance. It's about being an entertainer and just making something memorable, make people feel something, whether that's just laughing or whatever.
It's the same reason that YouTube videos that are viral, like the ones that are like, oh, how to pick up a girl, it's like they're using magic to tell a bigger story, but the magic is secondary, and the thing that's the primary or more important is either love, or whether that's a tutorial of something, and that always hits harder on a broader scale than magic, which is much more niche. So, use magic as like a storytelling tool, basically, and that seems to be what makes things more viral.
It seems like, I mean, for one example, when David Blaine came out with his first special, do you remember the people that were like, well, all he's doing is the invisible deck, and I have the invisible deck, and why not? I should be on the David Blaine special. And people, they confuse being a successful magician with being a successful entertainer or a compelling person in general.
That person doesn't understand why David Blaine, why that person connected with David Blaine doing that trick. And why they're not connecting with them. Like, that's like, so you can't teach someone that. Like,
technically proficient, greatest dexterity performer to be a great performer. Right. You just have to be a great performer.
If you play the guitar really, really well, if you play an electric guitar and you can, like, play crazy riffs, like, that's really impressive, but can someone, like, feel that sometimes? Like, when, like, they get into, like a groove or something, and you can just, like, kind of, like, bob your head, and you can just, like, feel the music. Like, to me, people appreciate this and this, but for me personally, like, I appreciate something that's just, like, more, like, in a groove, and you can, like, just, like, feel that. And so, yeah, I think that David Blaine kind of, like, touched on a lot of that. Like, he just found, like, a way to not get in front of the magic and not just, like, have it be about him, even though it is technically at the end of the day.
We're going to take a few more questions here. There's still questions coming in.
On a lighter note, nipple. Yeah.
Questions coming in about nipples. He's referring to Blake's story. Last week on Exposé, Blake was here, and he told a story about being meeting you for the first time, which was in a hotel room. This is going to sound super sketch. Anyway, watch Exposé last week.
I remember that.
Yes. And there's a video. Anyway, Calen, well, let's roll it right now.
Oh, he has a video?
No, we're gonna get to a few more questions here. We've got a lot of these already.
How can you be so successful, JB?
It's the pants. I'm not wearing any. That's just a secret.
Oh, you're not wearing pants too?
Two. See? Not the only one. No. I may or may not be. I told people earlier I'm not gonna confirm or deny that. I
told you it was hot here.
God dang.
Yeah, it is warm. So, yeah, you can't deny it. Andre, what should we do for a comment contest this week? We only have a few minutes left. We'll get to a few questions.
Give Calen a rap name, a rapper name. That's Kristen's idea.
I like this. Just Calen, wait, don't tell us, Calen. Do you have a rap name, or is it, like, your actual name?
Yo, you guys, I'm not I don't rap. Like, what do you, like,
okay, well, if Calen was a professional rapper.
It's only if you were a professional rapper. Because I feel like every person should have options, and you should human being should have a rap name in case you want to do that.
Okay.
No, just me.
Wake up tomorrow and be like, you know what? I'm gonna do 365 days of rap. And
okay, how about this?
Yeah.
How about this? Another one is Calen think of a name of an effect or an effect plot, and then somebody has to guess what it is in magic. It's totally random.
I like the rap name one.
I'm gonna go. Right, yeah, the rap name one. Like,
I like that better. Cool.
Okay, yeah. There we go. So we'll give you guys a minute to think about this. Post your rap name for Calen in the comments. Theory11.com/ Exposé. We're going to choose one in a moment. We'll get to a few more questions thereafter. What are we giving away this week, Andrei? Did we talk about a prize yet? Did you already say
prize? Calen? Can we give Calen away?
Calen, we're going to be shipping free around the world. He's going to be in a small box. We're going to put him in. That's what Sub Rosa is. It's actually Calen in this small box. We have to do something smaller. Let's do this. Andrei, I have two decks in front of me. Both of these are mystery box decks that we do with Bad Robot, J.J. Abrams. I have the black edition. I have the regular edition. Whoever wins this week, take home your choice, either one of these. But we're only going to choose one. So let's see. We got a bazillion of these. All right. So Calen, there's a lot. So I'm just going to I'll read through these. Khalil is Momo. Hopefully none of these are inappropriate because now I'm going to read them all. So there's Momo. There's Momo Magician. There's K-Dog with the W-D. There's Momo Money. There's Mr. Direction. That's interesting, like misdirection, but Mr. Direction, I guess. C Shizzle. There's C-Mo, pronounced C-Mo. Got it. Thank you for the clarification. Yeah. I needed that. CC Cool Calen, which is, I guess, playing off of LL Cool J. Well, these are coming in so fast. I'm trying to get to them.
Like nipples. That's awesome.
Yeah, MC Nipples with a Z. With a Z, guys. Lil K, MCCM, Jabrizzy, Calen. Hold on. These are coming in so quickly. Wiz Calen Ifa.
I'm not going to let you guys pick one. Like, I'm not going to pick my own rap name.
All right, Calen, you're McNibs. Okay, just kidding.
McNibs?
McNibs.
I see that McNibs. One. Yeah. McNibs. MCNibs. Not McNibs. It's not a McDonald's menu item, I'm sure. Yeah, I'll take
some
nipples with
Oh my goodness.
This like shows so how much like Andrei is.
There's so many. Christen, I think you need to be the one to call this. There's too many.
I think it's Kristen's job to call the rap name.
Oh no. Do I get to enter as well?
That would be awesome. You can enter, but you have to choose the winner.
But I will have they're still coming in. Oh my gosh. There's so many. I like puns. This is awful. You guys are too good at this.
I like puns.
I like puns. If I had to pick one that's like a legit rap name that I could see like actually being a thing, I would pick maybe I'm totally off because also I don't listen to rap, so please don't judge me.
Death metal.
Death metal. I'm like, yeah, death metal. Yeah. I like C-Mo.
C-Mo?
I like C-Mo.
Who is that? Who is that submission?
Oh gosh, it's back up here. Where are you?
All right. Momo Money.
Yeah. Momo Money. I don't know where it went, but it's up here.
Okay,
I'll find
so whoever that was. What was it, C-Mo?
C-Mo. Yeah, it's the Sunny G, I think.
The one with the clarification is like pronounced C-Mo?
Yes, because we have no idea how to pronounce the letter C correctly.
Whoever that was, we're going to scroll up and we'll find you. C-Mo will be Calen's rap name. His first album will be dropping tomorrow morning. We're really excited about it.
The first album's called Nips, so it'll be C-Mo.
It'll be called Momo's World.
Momo's World. Part time, excellent.
Yeah.
No? All
right, just me. So alone. C-Mo will take home the prize for that. You'll take home one of your pick of either of these things, your choice. So that is that. I'm trying to think of any good last final questions here we can take before we have to call this episode an episode. Calen, do you like cardistry? Ask Rhinomo. Rhinomo, like Dynamo, but with a Rye. Do you like cardistry?
He better.
Yeah, no, I do. I don't think they like I remember Chase like a year ago being like, yeah, you can't call yourself a cardist. And I was like, okay. But I mean I like practicing it. So
I remember the first time we were the night I was with you in New York where we were filming Dress Code. You were doing cardistry in my kitchen, my living room. So you were, this is not like
It's like, there's like so many good people right now that are like doing cardistry, and like it's like changed like styles like two or three times. I feel like two times in the past like short while that like technically people like this kid I met, he was like, yeah, do you do cardistry? He's like, I do XCM. And he like busted out some like DeVoe shit. And I'm like, I don't know if people think that's cool or not. But, you know, I don't know. It's interesting. I practice it, though. I just do it to like, get my mind off of stuff while I'm watching TV.
I like the name Calen Eminem as well. Calen Eminem. It's pretty good. I'll give you that one, too. That's really good. Yeah, no, so I think obviously we need to finish this with a cardistry battle between Andrei and Calen. It's the only natural way for us to finish this episode.
Wait, but now we need a rap name for Andrei so we can have an official battle off.
I already had a battle and I lost. Don't ask me to have another battle.
When was your battle? Oh, shit. That video was so... Oh, God, that was so good.
It was.
So funny.
Went viral.
That like kind of blew up too. Yeah, that was like 2 million, 3 million views or something.
Yeah.
Facebook views. It's dope.
Yeah. Facebook
Someone views. Asked, have you ever used magic as a pickup line? Like, have you ever used magic to pick up a lady?
Yeah, I used to do that like a lot up until I was like maybe a couple years ago, and now like I only do it honestly when I feel really awkward. But I have a short story. Okay, so I went out with this girl. And
you realize this is being broadcast live, right?
Yeah. I went out with this girl.
He's
right?
Never going to see it.
And I'm sitting in her truck, right? Because I was in LA and we were like, you know, I was going to get an Uber back to my hotel and she was like going to go into her house. And I was like, damn it. I gotta make the move. I got to. But I was like hesitating for some reason because like if I don't do something in 3 seconds, it's never going to happen, right? So then I'm like, screw it. So I like get ready to do French kiss and stuff because it's like, I'm like, I don't want to do this, but I know that this works, so why not? All right, so screw it. So I walk around the car, boom. Oh, this is your card, sign it, blah, blah, hack magician shit. Here, you put this in your mouth, I'll put this in. And she's like, wait, but I like seen you do this trick online before. And I'm like, what? I'm like, screw it. So I just like took the cards out of her mouth and kissed it. I was like, I don't need this trick.
That was so worth asking that question and going over time.
So,
hopefully she's watching.
That was the best.
Yeah.
Or you could use David Blaine's pickup line. Do you believe in magic?
No, David Blaine's pickup line is, want to roll the dice?
it's changed now. Wow, he's being creative.
Wait, what dice?
Anyways.
All right, I'm not going into this.
That's all we have. That's all we have for this week. Congrats to the person who posted about Simo and Calen Eminem. That's pretty great as well. I have to give some credit to that. It's pretty good. It's pretty good because it's got the...
There was no love for Wiz Kalanipa. Come on.
I like that one as well.
Wiz Kalanipa. Oh.
Andrei, oh, cardistry battle must do now.
I like that. Wiz Kalanipa. That's funny.
All right.
Theory 11 and logo. Ready.
Thank you guys for watching this week. We will be back again sometime soon, if not next week. Every Friday we have a different episode of Exposé. Every time we do these live exposés, we're going to have a different guest on these. Thank you to Mr. Calen Morelli for joining us this week. Definitely inspiring. Hope you guys got something out of this, learned something, were inspired to create, perform, whatever it is that you do. Thanks to Christen, thanks to Andrei, and all of you guys for listening, watching, participating, asking questions this week. Everyone sing battle. Andrei, give them something. Give the people what they want.
Oh.
I don't even have a deck of cards like
close. Well, Andrei wins by default. Done.
Yeah. I knew it. I knew it. All right.
Andrei, you can at least give them like a giant spring or something to quench this thirst for cardistry.
They got that card thirst. Ooh. Yeah,
you've seen it all before.
That's a dope. It's a good one.
That's all we got.
All
right.
We will see you guys on our next episode. Thank you for watching. Have a great weekend. Thanks to Calen and you guys again for watching.
See you guys.
See you guys.
Thank you.